I mean, basically, I just, I'll go do a little bit of intro of what we're doing. So we've been in Taiwan actually for almost five years. We're a social enterprise, Kipo.
Yeah.
We started out in Ethiopia, mm-hmm. and we built one of the first public emergency medical services systems. Mm-hmm. So they don't have EEGL, right? They don't have 911.
That's right.
So we built one that is like Uber version for that in 2013. So that's what we did a long time ago. And then that's a nonprofit that's still running now. We serve around 10,000 people in Ethiopia. Thank you. And then actually the group from Taiwan, you unfortunately did not get to come to visit our hospital, mm-hmm. but we did show some.
Yeah, the group from Taiwan did. It's a large delegate.
Yeah, it's a massive delegate. So unfortunately we didn't get to see, but so they're doing all right. Right now it's a little difficult because of COVID, but
I know.
But so we've been doing stuff along these lines, trying to do social impact for a while. And then in 2018, we launched PhysioQ, which is a nonprofit organization in the US that helps to basically build software for researchers. So like, you know, like you're from Silicon Valley, you know how great some software is. And then if you go to medical, you also know how behind a lot of software is as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we basically took a technology approach to democratizing research using wearable devices to reduce the cost. So like, you know, normally, you know how it is, right? So it's like, it's really expensive. So that's barrier entry is really high. And then if you have wearable device, one, most of them aren't open. And if they are open, you need to know how to code. Most doctors don't know how to code. Most, you know, researchers don't, not every researcher knows how to code. So we basically do the middle part for you and make a project management software. So that's LabFront. So that's what we were planning to launch in April, last month. So I was supposed to be in the US for February, March, April, and then Simon's laughing because we were discussing how I was supposed to be in the US, but obviously that did not make sense at the time. And so we can't launch our product. We want to do it, but there's stuff that's more important right now than just the research element.
Sure.
So we went and talked to our advisors. We work with a lot of doctors at Harvard Medical School on the public health side, and they were coming to us and they're really worried about what's going on, right? You know, like, and especially like Boston, New York, a lot of people that move back and forth with New York, you know, its cases going really high. They're worried that it's going to come to Boston as well.
That's right.
They're saying, what can we do about it? So from our side, after a lot of discussions, we basically came up with Neo, which is the project. I don't know if you saw a little bit of it. Yeah, but it's instead of just a project, just a research thing, which is not tangible to people, why don't we make something that can allow people to actually check in on family members? Like I'm living here in Taiwan, my family's in New York, my family's in Boston, my family's in San Francisco. How do I know that they're okay? And you know, and just asking them, you can't find out anything. But we already have a platform called LabFront that does data collection for research. So we just built an interface on top of it for families, just allow you to connect and get actual real data. And I saw that you had a conversation with Garmin, and they
along very much the same lines.
Exactly. So they told you all about their wearables. So I'm not going to tell you about their wearable, but there is really good things that they can collect that's actually both useful for research and useful for families to see. So what we do is you create your own family model, and you know you can add whoever you want into your family, and you take care of the data yourself, and you get to see everything. Now, because our platform is for research, so our thing is already encrypted, already HIPAA compliant, everything is whatever. Most users don't know or care, but it's already there.
Mm-hmm.
And then we basically offer them, you know, our partnership with Garmin right now. Mm-hmm. They are willing to give a discount on some devices if you donate your data for research purposes.
Mm-hmm.
So people that use Neo actually get to take action against COVID. They can actually take this, their data, and then contribute into the fight. Mm-hmm. And then so we're building a big, massive, anonymized data bank of Neo users from all across the world,
mm-hmm.
and then opening up to all researchers for free. Mm-hmm. It takes a little bit of time to organize all the data, but just allowing everyone to do this and do their part. So that's basically what we're doing right now, mm-hmm. and then. So when I was talking to Ray, you mentioned, well, that's like Taiwan can help. Like you guys are in Taiwan, you're doing something that's helping. Like maybe we should talk. And is there anything else we can do? Because we have nothing to sell. We're just trying to understand. Is there anything else we're doing? that can help what you're doing.
Yeah, I just had a very similar conversation with Palantir this morning.
Oh, really? Okay.
And they're offering their workbench software called Monocles in the any AWS instance. They can just spin it up and offer it for free for anyone working on COVID to build their own data pipelines. And we talk a lot about data visualization and building interactables so that everybody participating in the kind of data collaborative that you're describing and can understand first the actual impact they're having to this like a little bit of my input actually goes a long way toward evidence-based policymaking. And although you did mention that not a lot of people care about the data flow, the GDPR, HIPAA, and things like that, a really good interactable webpage is all it takes for people to start caring and start sharing. Because if they don't care, they don't curate their data.
Yeah,
and if they don't curate their data, much of that is noise.
Yeah. So that's the thing, right? You can't do it just for research. It has to have a value to them themselves.
That's right.
So our angle is, let's do it from the family angle. I think that makes perfect sense to take the what we're collecting and then visualize it on a larger angle as well. That makes perfect sense to me.
That's right. Because that then also visualizes not just the family connection part of the kind of emotional incentive, but rather the truly altruistic, like contributing to research.
Exactly.
But there's a connection between this one to that one, like a larger family of humankind, or things like that. So I think that's a really good angle that we're pursuing through our co-hack, Eneva, which I think we got a lot of ideas. It closes yesterday, and I did suggest Garmin and anyone who are interested to participate.
So how would they participate? Can you give me a little bit more information?
Sure. So CoHack is a week-long hackathon, and the hackathon topics were co-curated because this is under the umbrella of the U.S.-Taiwan joint statement to counter coronavirus. So we asked the top experts in the CECC here, the CDC here, the CDC there, to give us good ideas. Like good problem to be solved.
Okay.
And there are certain suggestions that may be legal in the US but not in Taiwan. For example, there was one suggestion that we should prioritize the ICUs so that when people come in, it's not on the first in, first serve basis, but rather on your remaining contribution to the society focus, which is illegal in Taiwan.
So yeah. Human right. Yeah.
But it's a very U.S. Way of thinking. so we did have a regulatory impact assessment, human rights assessment group that put a red light on it, so that wasn't discussed.
So don't worry. I don't have to worry right now.
So we keep the legal parts, and then for the last week, as for anyone who has some MIT license open source code, to record 3 minutes describing what your code base is and how it responds to one of the 6 category of our problem to be solved, and then we'll run a panel of judges. I'm not part of it. I'm just the one who calls people together, and then the experts will let us know which solution looks the most promising, and the winners will get a laser engraved from both sides rice cooker that could be used to disinfect the mask. It's very symbolic. But the engraving basically promises that their idea, if applicable to Taiwan, will be adopted by the CECC as the official platform. Not necessarily by a procurement basis, because you've already open sourced your code.
Yeah.
So chances are it will be running on private data.
Yeah.
Here within the CECC purview. But you'll be, of course, consulted of how to make use of this. So that's the structure. But many proposals, those 3-minute videos, describe solutions that are, frankly speaking, not very applicable to Taiwan because we've been like a month without community transmission. And so the US counterpart will also evaluate, although they did not commit to say they will always be implemented at federal level because they have a different relationship with the states.
Yeah.
So they will, of course, just push it as far as I can, and I will tweet those winners 3 minutes videos on my Twitter at least, which is some viewers, and that's the basic structure.
Okay, I understand. So anyone can apply for this?
That's right.
But it has to be open source.
Whatever you're describing need to be open source.
Yeah, sure.
But it could be operating on, for example, the kind of biometric or private data.
Yeah,
that's fine. But the code itself need to be able
to. So the final structure of this thing. Yes, for example, there are interfacing parts with, for example, a partner Garmin, where they have their.
Of course. So those adapters, of course, we understand are proprietary. But the one that you designed to address this issue, that core part, for example, the workbench and so on, the visualization, the dashboard, need to be open. So, and the reason why is that we, for international procurement tools, this is actually very difficult. Like for the US to procure a Taiwan winner, it doesn't really work, right? So that's out of a necessity.
Cool. When does it start?
So it's already.
It's already going on.
Yeah, it's actually closed yesterday.
So. Oh, okay.
We had this conversation a little bit too late. But if we announce the winners, they'll be very public. And so I'm sure that each of us can contribute to their work as well.
Sure.
That's essentially what Palantir was saying this morning.
Yeah.
Is that they offer the help to whichever winner. That there are. They've already worked with many kind of state-level hospitals across the world and so on, but they're also looking forward to partner with the social sector, private sector people if the government thinks this is a really good idea that has a good chance of being implemented. They're happy to work with them as partners as well as kind of a extension of their pro bono offer.
Okay, I understand. So I'm just curious then, because a lot of the current, you know, what is problems in other places are not so relevant here in Taiwan. What are the solutions that are you guys more interested in looking for, and what is the direction that you think is the direction that you want to be pushing yourself?
So first of all, this Taiwan Can Help campaign, right?
Yeah, sure.
So we were dedicating a lot of energy into designing things that helps other jurisdictions. So like the AI Labs, which has a open source implementation of the Bluetooth Trace Together Singaporean thing, but even more privacy preserving. And of course, we're not deploying it. We don't have a use of it now, but the UK is interested. So they're offering their source code and things like that. So we're happy to offer our kind of spare energy. Right, and just like we have spare mask protection facilities now, so we're asking people to go to the app and say whether they want to dedicate their uncollected mask. And now there's like more than 4 million masks of maybe 500,000 people or something who did not collect those masks, but they still have plenty of supply. Or if they can use the rice cookers really well to run the masks as I do. So they have spare. And so they just refrain from collection and dedicate, and their 30 mask goes to international partners. And so it's also a data collaborative in a sense.
Yes.
So that's part of that. And so what we're trying to do is to go beyond the traditional humanitarian, like state-to-state idea, but rather go epicenter to epicenter. Epicenter to epicenter. Each epicenter faces a very different set of challenges that are very different from every other epicenter. Even in the US, I mean, each epicenter is very different from each other. So we have a series of bilateral talks. Of course, we're looking to just write in detail our model and share it in the World Health Assembly. We'll see how that goes. but the fact is that we've been working a series of bilateral relationships with the ongoing epicenters when it comes to the research, the models, the understanding of the coronavirus, the incentive design of how a few people wearing masks taking care of themselves by reminding themselves not to touch their mouth and wash their hands properly can then, through selfish and not altruistic incentive design, remind other people to start wearing masks, which also protects themselves
in a kind of
altruistic byproduct.
That was the big thing for me, coming from an American background. You know, like masks are not part of the norm of society. Like actually just flipping that switch and understanding, it's like, it doesn't really matter what you're doing it for, because at the end you do have group immunity in a sense, because of the full the prevalence and
Lots of White House staff are now wearing masks.
I know.
Yeah, and they these masks all say made in Taiwan.
That's good.
Yeah, so that's our focus. It's mostly to share our experiences.
So what, how can we get connected on the help, how one can help, network? Like, what do we do?
Mm-hmm. Sure. So the first thing, of course, is go to the co-hack, and the winners will soon be announced.
Okay.
And work with the winners.
Okay.
Because they are going to be kind of the international team.
Okay.
Right, that they will symbolize the kind of help that we can concretely offer. And just like Frontier, if you can offer connected services, or if some of them already use wearable, then infrastructure, then you just plug right in to those infrastructure. So that's the first wave.
Okay.
The second wave is going to be the presidential hackathon.
Yeah.
And so we're now in the voting stage.
Yeah.
So you can also go there and vote
on
whatever ideas. And the presidential hackathon is not only concentrated on SDG3, which is what everybody is concentrating on, but rather it's looking at a post-corona world and look at all the sustainable development goals and see how that changes things, because it does change things. It lets people see that it's actually possible to hit the carbon emission targets. And if we want to have a revitalization of the economy, maybe we don't have to go back to the old normal of linear economy, can do circular design the right way. Because for once, everybody is sharing the same dashboard of data, and that makes circular economy actually work on international scale. And so the presidential hackathon has a lot of those ideas, and you can participate through the quadratic voting interface just to vote on the project that you think are good. And you can also offer yourself as resource people, as individuals, join those teams. And so the winner of presidential hackathon wouldn't get a rice cooker, but rather would get a microprojector. like we're a very electronics abundance island. So anyway, so if you turn on the projector, it will show the president's image, showing the president giving the trophy to the team, and promising whatever you've done in the past 3 months will become public policy nationally within next 12 months. And so it's basically the president sharing her executive power as the reward, but not necessarily as procurement. You just be invited as experts in allocating public budget to make that public infrastructure, or we can decide to ship it as a social enterprise and then just support the social enterprise with guaranteed business, basically, and things like that. So the presidential hackathon is the next step after this corona, which is hackathon, which is mostly about the next few months.
Okay.
The presidential hackathon is about the next year.
Okay, got it.
Uh-huh.
And then, so right now, so Neo's launching on the 15th in 2 days. And then we have, right now it's, the initial launch is US, Canada, Taiwan, but Taiwan is obviously not, you don't need it. It's more for people like me that are have family in other places. Yeah. And then we have about 10 other countries in Southeast Asia planned. So right now we have around 10,000 people on the wait list. So there's a good support behind it.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything there that we could leverage? Anything there that, that would be either networks that we could tap into to get the message out there or anything else?
Sure. So is this already localized? Like in terms of language.
So right now it's in English.
Ah, okay. So that makes it harder.
Because
it would take us 10 years to become a truly bilingual official language. That's the plan anyway.
We're translating in the works right now.
So with good translation, then there's plenty of ways that we can help. For example, just by sharing the fact that there is such a platform that if you have families overseas, you may want to connect them to. I mean, this YouTube video is one of ways to popularize that, because on average we have thousands or tens of thousands of viewers of these videos. And so just the availability of such a platform, I think is very, very powerful by itself. And if you can work your platform into one of the co-hack or presidential hackathon winners, then they get a lot of coverage. And that will, by its nature, become kind of an extension of your platform that shows not only your immediate application, but what you're capable of. And that's what we've seen in the past presidential hackathon cases. The reason why HTC or many other large brands participated in the presidential hackathon as volunteers, essentially, is not to earn a profit out of that participation, but to show all the ministers, because if the president gives the award and the minister says, oh, this requires a law change, we don't have the budget for that, all it takes is for the vendor to turn on the microprojector. And then the minister said, oh, we'll go and change the law. Yeah. Yeah, let's have a cross-ministerial meeting. That's what actually happened. It did really happen. So basically, then the relevant ministers will have to learn about your platform if it's part of the presidential hackathon team solution set. And so that's the amplification challenge. But I'm personally always willing to give it a try. So if you launch, I also have friends overseas. I also care about their whereabouts. Yeah. And so we can try it out together. I'm happy as your pilot user.
That would be awesome. How do I get information so I can send this stuff to you? I use the card? I'll send it to you when we launch. I think we'll translate to Mandarin, at least the info page and stuff, just so that we can get that, and then we'll move from there. The use case in Taiwan is not very high, so there's not a huge priority to do that.
That's right.
But so we're focusing, there's countries that...
Well, you can always cross-source the translation.
Yeah, like so that's what...
Transifex or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what we're looking at right now, to just do that.
Awesome.
So, we've been just busy working on there. It's great to hear that there's a bunch of other stuff. It looks like we missed out on both events.
but you can still vote on presidential hackathon.
Sure.
So you can share the ones that has the most energy to you. Mobilize a lot of people to vote.
Definitely. Engage the
stakeholders.
For sure. Awesome. Anything else? Any questions for us or anything that you want?
So why the name Neo? Are you Matrix fans or something?
Yes, exactly why. And it's, if you watch 2 and 3, they're fighting the virus, right? They're fighting Agent Smith. So, Neo, the one to fight the virus, right? So, gives you that power.
Okay, that's awesome. I actually have that Nokia phone, but I didn't bring it.
That's right.
They did a 4G version of that.
I got the flip one, which is the newer one, but not the 3. I also had that one,
the banana one.
I had the banana, but it broke.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Excellent. Good to
meet you. It was great to meet you. I'll follow up, and we'll see how we can continue.
Very good to learn about your work.
All right, okay. Awesome.
Cheers.
Thanks.
Bye.